is most gracious invitation. It is undeserved, this honor, but it is most appreciated. You know, I seize every little opportunity that comes my way for me to share whatever little I know about our Constitution, which is a subject which is very close to my heart. You know, I have been a teacher for more than almost 35 years, teaching this document, what we call the Constitution. I feel it is my duty to seize every opportunity to share what I know about this most important document, not only to students of law, but all citizens if given the chance. And these citizens will certainly include even the President of the Republic. So with your permission, I proceed. But before I do, I ask that you please pardon me for being out of uniform and for this facial and long hair. You see, I am on vacation. I am on what you may call a sabbatical. I have been writing. And I suppose I am in some sort of a medical break as well. People have told me that I may be afflicted already, well, as most others my age, no? With this syndrome known as EBAD, otherwise and more popularly known as EDAD. Hence the vacation. My wife will be more than happy to confirm this, no? I don't think that I am suffering from this ailment known as Alzheimer's disease, but ask my wife. I have already been displaying symptoms of this other, less serious ailment known as Alzheimer's disease. Sometimes I remember, sometimes I forget. So having said that, let that be some sort of a caveat as to how we will proceed today. This is a nice group, so let's just have a basic conversation. You know, I shall as a sign share with you what little I know of our Constitution. After my discussion, and if you have questions, I am confident that my beautiful mother, who is seated there at the Vietnam, would be more than happy to answer all of them. That is my reason for having asked my mom to accompany me this morning to lessen my load. Well, as you can see, Ria, where is Ria? I have prepared a speech. This is a departure from my usual lecture method because I usually speak just from my heart and from the hip. But because I was requested, I put some words down on pieces of paper. I will try my best to be faithful to these words that I have written, which anyway, I have written from my heart as well. And the statements here basically also shall emanate from my hip. Now, I have prepared this lecture not only as a teacher, more importantly, I would like to speak to you, with you, this morning, as one of your countrymen, as a simple citizen of our republic. You know, this, ladies and gentlemen, is my copy of the 1987 Constitution, which, as far as I know, remains effective, and therefore should still be both obeyed and upheld, regardless of whatever any president may say. I reject any president who considers himself to be above and therefore not bound by this Constitution. I oppose any president who may want to change our Constitution simply because he cannot understand it. You know, I dislike any president who publicly proclaims the Constitution, it is nothing to me. Any president for me who makes such a declaration should have no business remaining in that office. He should step down. Well, too early to be angry. So may I proceed with a little bit of lecture if you don't mind, no? They say that we have had 7 constitutions. Well, 8 if you are to include that document which briefly operated in our territory during the Second World War. This ladies and gentlemen, is the third of significance among all of our constitutions. Well, very briefly, let's just gloss through history. The Malolos Constitution, with which we are all familiar, this was the first ever democratic constitution in the entire Asia. It provided for a parliamentary system, but with a president and not a prime minister as head of government. Well, we know that this particular constitution was effective, in a sense, only for a period of 2 years, because even as we had just planted the seeds of our independence, Spain almost secretly ceded our country in favor of the Americans. And the Americans made sure that the government organized by President Aguinaldo would be short-lived. So, the Americans came very quickly and with a bit of force, replaced that government initially with a military government which presented a most dangerous confluence of executive, legislative, and judicial powers in but one military government. You know, happily for us, ladies and gentlemen. There were, at the time, libertarians in the United States Congress, having heard about this dangerous confluence of all three powers in but one military government, they decided to investigate. They therefore sent what was later to be known as the First Philippine Commission, headed by Mr. Shulman. It was a fact-finding effort. This commission reported back to the U.S. Congress. They immediately sent thereafter the Second Philippine Commission, headed by Mr. Tan. Slowly, the military governor was divested of two of the three powers. Well, to make a long story shorter, no? The Second Philippine Commission eventually led to the promulgation of the Philippine Bill of 1902. Which is recognized being an organic act as another constitution of the Philippines. You know, this second organic act, under the second organic act, executive power was vested in the civil governor and legislative power in the Philippine Commission. Now, this fundamental law paved the way for the creation in 1907 of the Philippine Assembly, which was a bicameral legislature. This persisted until it was dissolved when in 1916 the Philippine Autonomy Act, otherwise known as the Jones Law, was promulgated. You know, that law provided as well for a bicameral Congress consisting of a Senate and the House of Representatives. It was at this period in our history when the names of Quezon and Osmeña first became really very popular. This law provided for a semi-parliamentary form of government, with members of the bicameral Philippine legislature serving in the Governor General's cabinet without forfeiting their seats as legislators. Well, this system governed us until the promulgation of the Tidings-McDuffie Act, the law which authorized the establishment of the Commonwealth of the Philippines, and eventually the convoking of the Constitutional Convention in 1934. This was the convention which framed what was later to become our 1935 Constitution. It was ratified on May 14 of that year. You know, 6 months later, the Commonwealth government was inaugurated with Mr. Manuel Quezon as the first president and Mr. Sergio Osmeña as the vice president. You know, ladies and gentlemen, friends, no? Significantly, said constitution initially made by the 1934 Constitutional Convention, it initially provided for a unicameral legislature. It was an experiment of which Taro and Rector, he said this in his valedictory, he was most proud of that achievement. The constitution that they drafted provided for a unicameral legislature. So they experimented. It did not work because 6 years later, an amendment was made reverting back to a bicameral legislature. So that was our first real experience with a unicameral Congress. It failed, this experiment. Now, The presidential form of government established under the 1934 constitution, with a bicameral legislature, it persisted for more than 30 years, almost 40 years, or until 1973, when the new constitution, I call it the Aberrant Constitution, the Marcos Constitution, well, it became effective and it adopted a parliamentary system. This was our fifth constitution. Now, personally, I wish to say this was the constitution I studied as a student in the College of Law of San Beda. Now, this constitution transformed the president to a mere symbolic head of state. His powers were transferred to a prime minister who sat concurrently as head of state and of government and member of the unicameral National Assembly. Again, we experimented with a unicameral legislature. Well, that constitution was 8 years later, or 8 or 9 years later, amended. This was in 1981. The powers of the prime minister were returned to the president, who regained his control over the cabinet, although the prime minister, under that constitution, was still authorized to preside over its meetings. You know, this particular amendment done in 1981, this was question number one in my bar examination in 1982. It was not taught exactly to us in school, but I read the advanced copy of the decision. So I answered correctly question number one in our political bar examination. Now, this system continued until the dismantling of the dictatorship of Mr. Marcos in 1986. Proclamation number 3, our 6th constitution, otherwise known as our Freedom Constitution, was promulgated by President Corazon Aquino shortly after the so-called People Power Revolution in El Salvador. It paved the road toward the making of our 7th constitution, the 1987 constitution, which provided once more a return to the presidential system, again with a bicameral legislature. Now, I must stress this. This constitution was drafted by a most impressive assembly of jurists, legislators, educators, citizens. Among them were the Venerable Chief Justice Roberto Concepcion. I am happy that Chief Justice Hilario Davide is still around. Justice Cecilia Munoz Palma, who I think was then the only lady justice in that court, but who was acknowledged as the only justice who had balls in that court. But she was, I think, at one time, a president of this particular commission. Well, Justice Florence Di Regalado, I will mention him again later, he was also a member of this constitutional commission. Senator Ambrosio Padilla, Speaker J.P. Lauder, they were among the delegates or commissioners who wrote this constitution. Of course, I should mention, our beloved Father Bernas was with them as well. Now, this fair question arises. This 1987 constitution, is it a good constitution? We shall see. By definition, a constitution is that body of rules and maxims in accordance with which the powers of sovereignty are habitually exercised. Justice Malcolm offers a longer definition, one which my students dislike because it is long. It is a written instrument enacted by direct action of the people by which the powers of government are established, defined, and limited, and by which these powers are assigned to the several departments of government for the safe and useful exercise for the benefit of the body politic. My students can recite this. But then, class, my friends, you have to remember, I have less industrious, not lazy, no, less industrious students. When I ask them to define, they would offer to me this particular statement. It is the fundamental law. You know, ladies and gentlemen, I would also give them full credit in their recitation for this answer. For our constitution is indeed to repeat our fundamental yan. Allow me now in explanation to borrow my father's words. Emotion ako ng konti, medyo madrama yan. You know, the constitution is the basic and paramount law to which all other laws must conform and to which all persons, including the highest officials of the land, must defer. No act shall be valid, however noble its intentions, if it conflicts with the Constitution. The Constitution must ever remain supreme. All must bow to the mandate of this law. Expediency must not be allowed to sap its strength, nor greed for power debase its rectitude. Right or wrong, the Constitution must always be upheld, lest its disregard result in the usurpation of the majesty of the law by the pretenders to illegitimate power. So there you have it, class. The purpose of the Constitution is to prescribe the permanent framework of a system of government, to assign to the several departments their respective powers and duties, and to establish certain fixed principles on which government is founded. And so I ask again, is the 1987 Constitution written by the 1986 Constitutional Commission a good Constitution? In this regard, I should say, it is best to remember that no Constitution can be considered perfect. Our Constitution is only 31 years old. I am almost twice older than this document. Allow me to borrow once more from my father's words by way of explanation of what I mean. The Constitution must be quintessential and not superficial, the root and not the blossom, the base and framework of the edifice that is yet to rise. It is but the core of a dream that is yet to take shape, not in a twinkling by mandate of our delegates, but slowly, in the crucible of Filipino minds and hearts, where it will in time develop its sinews and gradually gather its strength and finally achieve its substance. In fine, the Constitution cannot, like the goddess Athena, rise full grown from the brow of the Constitutional Convention, nor can it conjure by mere fear an instant utopia. The Constitution must grow with the society it seeks to restructure and march apace with the progress of the race, growing from the vicissitudes of history, the dynamism and vitality that shall keep it far from being a petrified root, a pulsing, living law attuned to the heartbeat of the nation. In other words, friends, it should be understood that perhaps not enough time has actually passed since its promulgation for us to really be in a position to gauge whether or not this document written by these distinguished men and women would be or is good for our nation. So let us try to examine it very briefly in accordance with certain fixed standards for testing the goodness of constitutions. First, it is basic that a good written constitution must be broad, it must be brief, it must be definite. Every freshman knows this in the College of Law. It must be broad because it must not only provide for the organization of the entire government and cover all persons and things within the territory of the state, but also because it is supposed to embody the past. It is supposed to reflect the present. And it should be able to anticipate the future. It must be comprehensive enough to provide for every contingency. It should be not only the imprisonment of the past, but the unfolding of the future. We add here that it should be also the fulfillment of the present. Now, the second, every good constitution must be brief. It must confine itself to basic principles to be implemented with legislative details, more adjustable to change and easier to amend. A good constitution should be definite or clear, lest ambiguity in its provisions result in confusion and divisiveness among the people. The exception is with respect to rules deliberately worded in a vague manner, like for instance the due process clause, to make them more malleable in the light of new conditions and circumstances. So remember, broad, brief, definite. Let us now examine this constitution in accordance with those standards. Broad. My former students would remember my lectures here. I have often criticized this constitution as being over broad. Why is it over broad? You know, its Article 16, class, our friends, no? Contains provisions on the advertising industry. For the life of me, I never fully understood why this particular industry was given special importance in this document. My thinking is this, and I respectfully maintain this, this could have been covered simply by laws. Well, this article, these provisions in Article 16, class, they appear to be misplaced in a constitution. Let us go to Article 2, Section 24, by way of another example. It declares that the state recognizes the role of communication and information in nation building. Two words, no? Wow. I have never fully understood why it can be considered as important for us to make an announcement that the Philippines is the text or internet capital of the world in our constitution. Now we see, no, that this constitution, well, as described by my father in his classroom, and I heartily concur, is in a sense like me. It is a talkative constitution. Now, I cite the preamble. We, the sovereign Filipino people, imploring the aid of Almighty God, in order to build a just and humane society and establish a government that shall embody our ideals and aspirations, promote the common good, conserve our patrimony, and secure to ourselves and posterity the blessings of independence and democracy under the rule of law, the regime of truth, justice, freedom, love, equality, and peace, to ordain and promulgate this constitution. It is law. And did you notice? It includes the word love. Yeah. You know, it captured my attention, this word, when I first read it. And it led me to research on this. I reviewed the records of this Constitutional Commission and I discovered that there was only one member, commissioner, delegate, who objected as to the inclusion of the word love in the preamble. This was Commissioner, the late, very talented Commissioner Lino Broca. His reason for his objection, and I quote, he said, "It's yucky." He was, well, maybe right? I don't know. Please do not misunderstand me. No? My wife is here to attest to this. I am a romantic. I am all for love. But perhaps the concept of the word would be more appropriate in a romantic novel, like, well, a Niels and Boone novel, other The Fault is in Our Stars. Other romance novels or stories. The Avengers, maybe? Suicide Squad? I don't know. But perhaps not
Sunshine.
But perhaps not in a constitution. The only other mention of love in our constitution is found in Section 3, Paragraph 2 of Article 14, which speaks of, and I quote, love of humanity. How nice. I think that's okay. Now, is this constitution brief? I'll tell you this. Article 2 of this document alone has 28 sections. It has so many, perhaps too many provisions on social justice. One provision on this most important concept would have sufficed. Section 10 of Article 2 provides that the state shall promote social justice in all phases of national development. Maybe this should have been enough. Well, no, there are so many other provisions in this constitution on social justice. And here is another thing that I would like to stress, and this is pertinent to the requirement that the Constitution must be clear. You know, many of its provisions, I will confess, I have been teaching this for almost 35 years, for 31 years. I have never fully understood what these phrases or statements in this Constitution mean. There is nothing definite or clear about them. Let me just cite three examples this morning. This is known by heart, Section 16 of Article 2 provides that the state shall protect and advance the right of the people to a balanced and healthful ecology, and I quote, in accord with the rhythm and harmony of nature. I have tried my best to understand that. To this day, I do not understand or know what it means. All right? Let me jump now to the next section in Article 2. Well, it declares that the state shall, among others, give priority to education, science, etc. The state is also called upon to promote, and I quote, total human liberation and development. Let's dwell upon this phrase for a minute and try to understand what it is to be totally humanly liberated and developed. I cannot fathom the meaning of this particular phrase. My favorite. Article 16, Section 10. The state shall provide a policy environment for the full development of Filipino capability and the emergence of communication structures suited to the needs and aspirations of the nation and the balanced flow of information into, out of, and across the country in accordance with a policy that respects freedom of speech and of the press. Again, the two words service. Who? What? My father is famous for his reaction to this particular provision. He said, excuse me? But having said all of those things, allow me now to hop over to the other side. Let us go back to that word love in the preamble. Students of labor law would remember this. There is this tale told in a decision of the Supreme Court of a high school teacher who fell in love with her student. Well, because of that love, because that relationship was considered immoral, she was dismissed. Alam nila yung case. You know, she appealed that from that dismissal, and her appeal reached the Supreme Court. Happily for her, it landed on the desk of a most romantic jurist, my former teacher, Justice Florence Di Regalado, who was quick to pronounce, by way of paraphrasing this philosopher named Blaise Pascal. He said, in exonerating this high school teacher, if the two fell in love despite the disparities in their ages and academic levels, this only lends substance to the truism that the heart has its own reasons that reason itself does not know. Certainly, yielding to this most gentle and universal emotion should not be quickly equated with immorality. He added, the deviation of the circumstances of their marriage from the usual societal pattern cannot be considered as a defiance of contemporary social norms. So you see, class, my friends, love, it was actually invoked for purposes of dispensing justice. So, what is my point? There is a point in the inclusion of the word love in the preamble, for it can be a good thing. In this case, it was a wonderful thing. Now, Section 16 of Article 2, which speaks of a balanced and healthful ecology in accord with the rhythm and harmony of nature. You know, it is this particular bewildering phrase which led our Supreme Court, it was relied upon by our Supreme Court, in allowing an environmental suit to prosper, even if it were filed by children yet unborn. And this provision, whatever it may mean, was actually invoked by the Supreme Court for purposes of even promulgating special rules on environmental cases, precisely by way of protection and advancement of our rights to a balanced and healthful ecology. So you will see, again, my friends, there is a point in this, in the inclusion of this seemingly strange statement in Article 2, Section 16 of our Constitution. Now, in similar vein, I should say that there should be nothing innately wrong in calling upon the state to promote total human liberation and development, whatever this may mean. I have thought about it for a long time. Total human liberation and development, this can probably be achieved only in death. But how can that be bad for the state to pay attention to our total human liberation and development? Now, remember that provision where the state recognizes the role of communication information and Article 16, Section 10, what I refer to as the excuse me provision? You know, I am not a student of commercial law, but I did read this decision class. The Supreme Court actually invoked these two provisions for purposes of directing the application of the all-important must-carry rule in a commercial law case. So you see, again, there was use for the seemingly useless provisions. Our Supreme Court made sure that in their interpretation of these provisions in our Constitution, that it provided for the application of a most important rule in the field of commercial law. So, you will see, despite my initial comments, these provisions are actually good things and are essentially compliant with the requirements that this constitution should be broad, brief, and definite. So I ask again, is the 1987 constitution a good constitution? Let us examine it further, this time in the context of what are considered to be essential parts of the Constitution. The students of law know this. The three parts of the Constitution will be the Constitution of Government, the Constitution of Liberty, and the Constitution of Sovereignty, which I shall briefly tackle in seriatim. Our Constitution has all three. Its constitution of government consists of a series of provisions outlining the organization of the government, enumerating its powers, laying down certain rules relative to its administration, and defining the electorate. These are found or provided for in Article 6 to 11 of our present charter. Our time is limited, so allow me to focus only on the principal features of this segment of our constitution. I shall be speaking only on the first, the principle of separation of powers, and second, because it appears to be relevant these days, the matter of local autonomy, as provided for in these provisions that I mentioned. I start with the principle of separation of powers. Now, this constitution establishes basically three branches of government. The president, our chief executive, who is also the head of state and the head of government, he implements the laws made by our Congress. He does join in the process of legislation, but alone he cannot legislate. Our Supreme Court, our judiciary, in turn, interprets the laws. I offer a modest analogy to explain this principle, although I am uncertain if this explanation would be apt. I discuss this now in the context of my family. My lovely wife, Joy, in my family, she is the one who makes the law. She makes the rules. I should say this now, with all obeisance and in absolute obedience, I implement her rules. Our two daughters, they judge me. There is a separation of powers in my family. In other words, this segment of our Constitution features the principle of separation of powers, which is all important and most essential in any Republican and Democratic regime. The purpose is obvious. There is danger a all three powers of government were to be merged in but one entity, or but one individual, or both, if they were to be merged in a monster. Such a confluence of all three powers of government, aimed but a single person, would most certainly result in tyranny. Accordingly, it has been declared that the doctrine of separation of powers is intended to prevent a concentration of authority in one person or group of persons that might lead to an irreversible error or abuse in its exercise to the detriment of our republican institutions. According to Justice Lowell, it is intended to secure action, to forestall overaction, to prevent despotism, and to obtain efficiency. This cardinal postulate explains that the three branches of government must discharge their respective functions within the limits of authority conferred by the Constitution. Under the principle of separation of powers, neither the Congress, the President, nor the judiciary may encroach on fields allocated to the other branches of government. Now, I add to this, and it was Franklin Delano Roosevelt who made this declaration. He said, the letter of the Constitution wisely declares a separation, but the impulse of common purpose declares a union. Now, this is the reason why this doctrine is accompanied in our Constitution by provisions which make for what is known as a blending of powers, where we see our co-equal and independent branches of government working together for the promotion of the general welfare or the common bill, common good. Thus we see, bills become laws only after prior presidential scrutiny and approval. Certain appointments of the President are required to be subjected to similar prior scrutiny by either the Commission on Appointments or the Judicial and Bar Council. His treaties or international agreements can become effective only upon prior concurrence of the Senate, and his decrees of amnesty under the Constitution can be effective only upon prior concurrence of our Congress. These are but a few of the examples of how these branches of our government are made to, and I quote, work together under our Constitution. Within it comes as well the equally important principle of checks and balances, under which one branch may prevent excesses or encroachments by the others. By way of illustration, thus, bills may be vetoed by the President. This veto may be rejected by the Congress with what is referred to as its overriding vote. Pardons may be granted by the President for purposes of setting aside determinations of the judiciary in criminal cases. The Congress may impeach and eventually even remove high public officials. The Commission on Elections may not deputize law enforcement agencies without the concurrence of the President. In turn, the President may not pardon election offenses without the prior favorable recommendation of the Congress. Checks and balances. These measures in our Constitution are all intended, I repeat, to secure action, to forestall overaction, to prevent despotism, and to obtain efficiency. Now, of course, all of these principles, while all good, can be effective and can work properly only if the men called upon to implement them were to respect them. After all, the inclusion of these concepts in our Constitution, well, it is no guarantee, no? That we can prevent, or they can prevent, collusions among selfish men who man our different branches of government, especially if these selfish men pursue only selfish purposes for purely selfish ends. The executive, he must be strong. But the Congress must have a mind of its own and not be a mere rubber stamp. And insofar as our judiciary is concerned, it must always be independent. Our judges, to paraphrase Lord Coke, must always and only do what becomes them as judges. If this were not so, if only the President were strong, and our Congress and our judiciary were to be subservient to him, then, ladies and gentlemen, our republic is lost. An equally important feature of a charter's constitution of government will be the provisions on, to paraphrase Mr. Thomas Jefferson, our little republics known as our local governments, which comprise our greater republic. As little republics, they all essentially possess the fundamental powers of government. This is through valid delegation. I refer, of course, to the police power, to the power of eminent domain, and the power of taxation. Now, our constitution guarantees their autonomy, which would importantly include their right to pursue their political, economic, social, and cultural development, but within the framework of an existing state, consistent with their constitutional right to internal self-determination. Well, the case of province of North Cotabato versus government of the Republic of the Philippines, no? In this case, the Supreme Court made a very important pronouncement. The people's right to self-determination should not, however, be understood as extending to a unilateral right of secession. The local autonomy of our LGUs, well, it is provided for in basically two provisions, no? Section 25 of Article 2 and in Section 2 of Article 10 of our Constitution. This is sought to be achieved under our charter through basically the process known as decentralization, which, as explained recently, a 2016 decision of the Supreme Court, the case of Mangune versus Ermita. There, the Supreme Court said that this autonomy refers to the devolution of national administration, not power, to local governments. This would essentially involve the transfer of powers, responsibilities, and resources for the performance of certain functions from the central government to these local government units. This transfer of these powers has been provided for under our present local government code. This is important. Sections 4 and 16 of Article 10 of our Constitution, well, it says that the President shall exercise only the power of general supervision, not control over all local government units. This would include, of course, general supervision only over autonomous regions. These provisions clearly are intended to further strengthen the autonomy of our local government units. In addition, I add, the Law-Socrates Commission on Audit tells us that local governments enjoy as well fiscal autonomy, although they are still subject, as all other government entities are subject to, the constitutional audit jurisdiction of the Commission on Audit. I repeat this, no one is exempt from the audit jurisdiction of the Commission on Audit, no matter or regardless whatever any president may say, because that is what is provided for in this constitution. To bolster their fiscal autonomy, and I think this is pertinent to these economic concerns by way of support, economic arguments supportive of this nonsense called federalism. No? To bolster the fiscal autonomy of the local government units, Section 5 of Article 10 provides, and I quote please, no? Each local government unit shall have the power to create its own sources of revenues and to levy taxes, etc. Well, the local government code and the real property tax code, among other laws, best or confer upon the local government units this power to create their own sources of revenue. Section 6 of Article 10 entitles them to have a just share, as determined by law, in the national taxes which shall be automatically released to them. Until recently, we had referred to this share as the IRA, I think, no? Tony, it is Internal Revenue Allocation. This was altered only this year by our Supreme Court in the case of Mandanas versus Ochoa, July 3, 2018. the Supreme Court interpreted the phrase national taxes to include all national taxes and not just internal revenue taxes. Customs duties, for instance, would be included. So you see, the percentages assigned by law in favor of local government units would result in actually bigger shares now that these percentages would be based on all national taxes and not just internal revenue taxes. What would that be if that further bolstering the autonomy of local government units? Finally, Section 7, another taxation or economic provision in Article 10. It is provided there that all local government units are entitled to an equitable share in the proceeds of the utilization and development of the national wealth within the respective areas. So you see, power to create their own sources of revenue. Just share in the national taxes. Equitable share in the resources found within the respective areas. The elements, the ingredients for a meaningful autonomy, they are already there in terms of the economies of these local government units. It's not a question of their being implemented properly. I will go back to this. We can see from all of the foregoing that, as pronounced by the Supreme Court, and may I quote from a Supreme Court decision, the autonomy of the LGUs as thereby ensured does not contemplate the fragmentation of the Philippines into a collection of many states or the creation of imperium in imperium. I just said those words to impress you. I didn't to pretend that I know Latin, no? The grant of autonomy simply means that Congress will allow the LGUs to perform certain functions and exercise certain powers in order not for them to be overly dependent on the national government. The important thing here is that the autonomy does not contemplate the fragmentation of the Philippines into a collection of many states. Now, all of the things I have said on local autonomy, these are the reasons why I have never liked this concept known as federalism, which for reasons I truly cannot understand is being pushed by this administration. You have time, Pat? You know, this federalism, and I again quote, it is a mode of political organization that unites separate states or other polities within an overarching political system in such a way as to allow each to maintain its own fundamental political integrity. The key word here, my friends, for me is this, unites. But as our Supreme Court has explained, our country has no many states to unite. We are not a divided nation with sovereign components which require unification. Ladies and gentlemen, there is always division in any democracy. That is a given. There should be only unity in true love of country. But we are not, in the context of federalism, a divided nation. We are not comprised of many states which require unification to make a, quote, perfect union. Our Constitution already provides for this union, and as well, the rules that are supposed to govern this union. This federalism of this president, I tell you this, it will divide us. It will destroy our republic. It is, in other words, not good. The autonomy of LGUs is as assured in our Constitution. So our Constitution is not the problem here. Rather, the problem lies in the character of the men who are called upon to implement this Constitution. The men we elect to office and to whom we entrust the enforcement or the implementation of our charter. There lies the real problem. Now, may I just add this now? I have another, a selfish reason for opposing or rejecting this federalism. You know, if our Constitution were to be revised, friends, I would need to revise as well all of my books. And as I explained to you, I am already afflicted with this syndrome called Edad. I don't think I would care to change my books. Now, there are so why the details pertinent to these two components or concepts in our constitution. I regret I cannot incorporate or compress 45 hours into a 45-minute lecture. So now let us briefly, my final points now, let us go to the Constitution of Liberty, which consists of a series of prescriptions setting forth the fundamental civil and political rights of the citizens and imposing limitations on the powers of government as a means of securing the enjoyment of those rights. These are found class in Articles 2, 3, 4, 5, and 12 of our Constitution. These fundamental powers of the state, the police power, the power of eminent domain, the power of taxation, as exercised by the government, they can be good things, but in the hands of terrible men, and if exercised arbitrarily, they can be such terrible powers. Hence the need for the Bill of Rights, the need for these aforesaid prescriptions which would enhance our basic and civil political rights, but more importantly also for purposes of imposing limitations on the exercise by the government of its powers as a means of securing the enjoyment of those rights. You know, these rights of ours, they are found mainly in our Bill of Rights, which among others hold sacred our right to due process of law, both with respect to the requirement as to the intrinsic validity of laws, which is referred to as substantive due process. This is defined simply but rather dramatically by Chief Justice Fernando as responsiveness to the supremacy of reason, obedience to the dictates of justice. Justice Frankfurter offers a simpler definition of substantive due process. It is the embodiment of nothing more, nothing less than the sporting idea of foreplay. I'm sorry, fair play. Pardon me. And then there is the other aspect of due process, which is referred to as procedural due process. You have heard this before. This is the law which hears before it condemns, which proceeds upon inquiry and renders judgment only after or upon trial. These are two important aspects of due process. Now, the same Bill of Rights provides for all of us equal protection under our laws, which should allow, if needed, only for discrimination based only on substantial distinctions. The Bill of Rights also affords to us the most important right against unlawful arrests and unreasonable searches and seizures. It also presents to us our sacred right to privacy, rights guaranteed for all of the accused and many more. Now, most important for me though, among all of these freedoms or rights granted in the Bill of Rights, would be the provisions on our freedom of expression, which is usually the first of all freedoms that is sought to be curtailed by any repressive regime, which is intolerant of any criticism, which destroys all those who will offer or dare dissent, which is selfish in its purposes, and which is simply afraid of the truth. Now, permit me to share with you a favorite quotation of mine, this time from the Venerable Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes in his decision in the case of Abrams versus U.S., which captures essentially the philosophy of freedom of expression. He wrote, "When men have realized that time has upset many fighting faiths, they may come to believe, more than they believe, the very foundations of their own conduct, that the ultimate good desire is better reached by a free trade in ideas, that the best test of the truth is the power of the thought to get itself accepted in the competition of the market, and that truth is the only ground upon which their wishes can safely be carried out. That at least is a theory of the Constitution. It is an experiment, as all life is an experiment." Now, our Constitution has all of these prescriptions and as well proscriptions against the state in its exercise of its powers through government. These are good things, and all we really need are men and women in government who understand these rights of ours and who shall respect these rights of ours, because it is simply their duty to understand and respect them. Now finally, no? As to our Charter's constitution of sovereignty, which consists of the provisions pointing out the mode or procedure in accordance with which formal changes in the fundamental law may be brought about. This is found in Article 17. There are two steps involved in any proposal, in any changing of our constitution. The making of the proposal and then the approval of the proposal, called as the ratification, required to be done in advance. There are three methods for making the proposal. The first is by Congress directly, acting as a constituent assembly. Congress, as a constituent assembly, may, upon a vote of 3/4 of all of its members, propose either an amendment or a revision of the Constitution. An amendment is a piecemeal change. That is a basic understanding. For instance, if a change in the Constitution were to be effected, the age of the retirement age of judges, if it were to be changed from 70 to either older or younger, that is an amendment. A revision, on the other hand, would pertain to a basic alteration of the system, structure of government. Well, these are among the things that were discussed in the case of Lambino versus Cogalef, cited by the handsome Dean Joey earlier. No? Well, here's my point. The Congress, acting directly as a constituent assembly, can propose either an amendment or a revision. Now, if it feels, as it ought to, no? As it ought to, if it feels incompetent to propose either an amendment or a revision, then it can convoke, by 2/3 vote of all of its members, a constitutional convention. The basic understanding here that if there were to be a constitutional convention, then its task should be to propose a revision and not just an amendment. Because if it were to be just an amendment, then it would be impractical in terms of the costs involved. So there you have it, the first two modes. Congress acting directly as a constituent assembly, Congress convokes a constitutional convention, which in turn makes the proposal. And there is a third method, which was also the subject of the case cited by Mr. The handsome Dean Joey, the matter of initiative on amendment, to which the matter of proposing but only amendments to the Constitution, this is entrusted to us, the people, by way of this procedure, which is nowhere in our Constitution, known as initiative and referendum. Right? Now, I should mention this at this point. These are among my reasons for never having even bothered to study the proposal of this president's so-called consultative commission for this shift to federalism. Why? Because any proposal to revise our constitution, any effort toward this, must emanate from the Congress. And the Congress alone. The President, he of course can make suggestions, but he has no business under this Constitution to actually propose a shift from unitary to this federalism of this on the basis of this consultative commission which he established in December of 2010. I know at the establishment, I studied it. No? It was on the strength of an executive order which he promulgated all on his own. December of 2016, within 6 months from his having been catapulted to that office. Now, it was by way of an executive order. My friends, this is my point. By definition, an executive order can be promulgated only for purposes of implementing existing laws or for purposes of implementing the Constitution. As far as I know, as of then, December, even up to now, there has been never any law, or much less a resolution of the Congress acting as a constituent assembly, asking this president to help them in Congress to craft a federalism constitution. So he had no business promulgating that executive order. My humble view here, but of course I'm just a teacher, is that that executive order is unconstitutional. It has no basis either in law or the Constitution. How can it be based on the Constitution when it seeks to change the Constitution? That's my point. Yeah. But of course, again, I repeat, I'm only a teacher. Huh? Well, but this is something I am concerned with a bit. guaranteeing that it is only the Congress which can propose. So see what has happened. Congress, I think, has actually already disregarded the proposal made by this consultative commission of this president. Now, this is my major concern here. There have been reports to the effect that the handsome Chief Justice Uno is now angry. Huh? We should all be concerned when handsome jurists get angry. You know? But this would not matter to all the members of the House of Representatives, but I understand this matter is now being tackled. Why? Because Chief Justice Puno and his entire consultative commission, they never had any real business or legal authority to make those proposals and now therefore insist that those proposals be considered. Here my point, class, it is only the Congress which can do this. Can you imagine the public expense, no? Incurred for purposes of that consultative commission, all for what? All only for its proposal to be disregarded in toto by this Congress. Maybe it's because this Congress cannot understand what they propose. Yes, that's a reality. That may be a reality. At any rate, I proceed now. Once the required votes for the proposals are mustered, the same are submitted to the people for the ratification or approval in a plebiscite, which must be held not earlier than 60 nor later than 90 days from the approval of the proposals. It is important to note here that Article 7, Sections 1 and 2 do not indicate that the votes for the making by the Congress of the proposal or for its convoking a constitutional convention, but it is not indicated that their votes, 3/4 for the direct proposal, 2/3 for the constitutional convention, it is not indicated there that this should be done by the Congress separately. Remember that we have two chambers. The thinking is that, well, the thinking of Congress is that this can be achieved, the 3/4 vote can be achieved by a joint vote, which you will understand is an easier vote to master, as opposed to a separate 3/4 vote, meaning 3/4 there in the Senate and 3/4 as well down there in the House of Representatives. Yes, I use the word down there. Yeah. Intentionally. Please, Chairman Payuma. Alright. This can be a problem. If they persist in their present nonsense called federalism, well, this would be a good opportunity for our Supreme Court to finally resolve this, you know, persistent problem in law school, whether or not the 3/4 and 2/3 vote should be done separately or jointly. Well, I maintain, not the correct view here, the better view, I think, is that these votes required under the Constitution must be made by both houses voting separately. The reason is simple. If bills were to be approved with separate votes, then all the more reason should this constituent act of proposing changes to the Constitution, which should be considered as more important. Yeah? All the more reason that it should be also subjected to a separate vote. But then, you know, as I said only a while ago, I'm just a teacher. It is only for the Supreme Court to finally decide on this. So I will wind up now. No? I'm beyond my time already. So there you have it, ladies and gentlemen. The ingredients, the factors which can help us answer the question I asked earlier. Is the 1987 Constitution a good Constitution? It is to repeat an imperfect document, but I maintain respectfully that it is a good document. It is a good constitution. It provides for order in our society under reasonable terms, acceptable conditions, tolerable requirements. It is for certain not a panacea which can address all of our society's ills. I do not believe that that was ever the intention to begin with. But it does provide our nation with every good opportunity and with good processes for us to address all things wrong in our republic. I have written this before, I will reiterate. At the very least, this constitution ensures that our democracy continues to fare well in our nation. This is evidenced by the continuing clashes between authority and liberty, with, as ever, the Supreme Court, our Supreme Court, the conscience of the government acting as a final arbiter, and with only the Constitution the true guardian of the full flowering of freedom, standing as its firm foundation. The experiments on the extent of the powers of government and of our liberties, as founded in our Constitution, they consist. I am with my father on this as well. I do not suggest here that there is an eternal conflict between authority and liberty. There is none, in fact. The democratic society is based upon the need for the establishment of order as an imperative for the observance of rights. Authority and liberty, they must exist. There must be an equilibrium between them. But while order must first be established before rights can be exercised or enjoyed, the highest function of authority is to exalt liberty. This is our 1987 Constitution provides for. It carries this command upon our authorities. There can be no true order in our country if those who govern do not care to comply with, to obey these commands, and only because they think they are popular. The problem, in my view, ladies and gentlemen, has never been our constitution, which I maintain is a good constitution. The real problem may be this. We keep electing the wrong men and women to public office. Many of them do not understand, and therefore do not care about what our constitution is all about, what it is and what it stands for. In other words, the problem, I'm sorry, but the problem may be us. We are not truly free if each of us has to constantly assert his rights provided for in our constitution before or against these men and women who do not care for them and care only for themselves and their power and only because they, again, think they are popular. Our constitution is in place precisely to prevent these men who think themselves popular, these pretenders to be legitimate power, from usurping the majesty of the law. It is our duty, therefore, as citizens, to make sure that they are prevented from doing this or from continuing to do this. To achieve this, each of us, I most respectfully submit, must try and understand our constitution. Must acknowledge that it is there to provide order and as a guarantee for our proper exercise of all of our rights and of our freedom. We must embrace the Constitution, for it is, as I said when I began, our fundamental law. So, dear friends, I end with this plea. Join me. Let us all embrace our Constitution so we may better exalt our liberty. Grazie a tutti.